Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Darkness Unleashed by McKenzie Hunter. Narrated by Jorjeana Marie. Chapter 1. Ethan kept his eyes on the computer screen, occasionally looking up from it, anticipating another question. I'd been questioning him since the night before, when I'd watched Stephen get arrested. Ethan returned his attention to the laptop. He was calm, which should have soothed me. It didn't. He was too calm. My irritation flared. 14 hours had passed since Stephen's arrest. Every time I thought about it, I remembered the look of desperation and fear on his face, the haunted look in his olive-green eyes, the vulnerable and trapped way he'd looked when they'd placed him in handcuffs. And now? He was probably locked in a cell, a cage, waiting to be formally charged. I clenched my hands so tightly my nails dug into my palms. "When do you plan on going to get Stephen out?" My voice was strained, irritated. "The answer hasn't changed since you asked me 30 minutes ago. They have to process him. Once he is, I will be there to post bail," he responded in a low, even tone, biting back his annoyance. I considered sitting next to him and watching the evidence against Stephen. A video clip, no longer than 4 minutes, showing him killing 3 men. It had gone viral right after his arrest, and anyone could view it on YouTube or any social media site. To most, it depicted a calm Stephen approaching 3 men and their dog. What others thought was an incipient argument that became inexplicably explosive was actually an altercation between were-animals over territory. Most viewers didn't know that when the men tensed up, it was an act of aggression. When they stiffened and moved back as if they were cowering in fear, they were actually giving themselves room to shift to their animal forms. And the so-called dog Stephen killed was in fact a shifted canidae. But at a glance, which was all the video allowed, I couldn't tell which type. The clip ended before the canidae could revert to human form, as shifters did in death. When I finally tired of pacing the floor, I took a seat next to Ethan. "You really need to get some sleep. Once his bail is set, I promise I can go get him. He won't be there a minute longer."
"This isn't the first pack arrest I've dealt with," he said.
"Who else has been arrested?"
"Sebastian, Gavin, and..."
He paused.
"Me."
He must have thought his being arrested would shock me. It didn't. I would have been more surprised if he hadn't landed on the list at least once.
"And every time, the charges were dropped," he said confidently.
"Were they murder charges? Was there a video of the murders?" I spouted back, my voice coarser than I would have liked. Anger and frustration were making it more difficult to control. "Did they have a jerk with extensive resources?"
"It will be okay,"
Ethan said, his hands covering mine, but his words didn't possess the same confidence that they had earlier. Perhaps he'd realized the magnitude of the situation. It was Dexter, who had become a pain in our ass. Not only had the mage aligned himself with the witches to create a formula that would nullify were-animals' immunity to magic, but he had also orchestrated Stephen being filmed because we'd dared to stop his plans. Thinking about it piqued my anger. Winter's head snapped back when my fist connected with her jaw, and she retreated a couple of steps and then grinned. A prideful display that had an undercurrent of sadism and the same adoration and lust for violence that was innate in most were-animals. That was where our differences were most notable. I didn't revel in the barbarity of fighting, but they did. Something about fighting exerting dominance, defending themselves against any threat, spoke to them on a primal level where the beast dwelled. I just didn't want to die. That was my sole purpose in learning to fight.
feeling weak and preyed upon was something I never wanted to experience again. It wasn't about protection today. I wanted a distraction, and defending myself against Winter's violent onslaught was just the thing. I couldn't think about Stephen and his predicament. Nothing seemed to keep Dexter out of my head, and the rage he inspired fueled my assault on Winter. She was a special type of strange. She seemed happy that a roundhouse kick had landed her on her back several feet away. I glanced at the window in the door of the room where we always sparred when we weren't at the Pack's house. I preferred being at the Pack's house, where people rarely watched us. If they did, it certainly wasn't with the wide-eyed morbid intrigue or ardent disgust our aggressiveness drew in this place. It was one of the few gyms that had the type of room we needed. Upstairs contained the latest and newest equipment, areas for CrossFit, classes, and plenty of endorphin junkie members and people just attempting to lose those last 10 pounds or so. Winter and I didn't have any interest in the beautiful equipment and always went straight for the door at the far corner of the gym that led to the basement, which was rightfully referred to as the dungeon. It was dark and dingy, and it was obvious minimal work was put into its upkeep. Dull white walls had large patches of exposed drywall. The owner had given up on trying to repair the damage. A boxing ring took up part of the room, and in the corners were heavy punching bags. Free weights cluttered the floor. No one really followed the rules of returning the equipment. Upstairs, hints of sweat, cleansers, soaps, and body sprays wafted out of the locker rooms. The smells of sweat, blood, and aggression dominated the dungeon. People used it to spar, practice martial arts, and fight. Some members joked that it was where gladiators were made. Winter was great at teaching me how to survive. If I could walk out of a session with her on my own 2 feet, I was more than likely going to hold my own with someone else. "We have an audience again," I said, positioning myself into a ready stance. I was always on the defensive with Winter and prepared for anything. "Don't we always? We're the women who have something really wrong with them." She grinned, using the back of her hand to wipe the blood from her lips from a strike I'd delivered just moments before the kick. I forced a chuckle, but there wasn't enough levity in me to make it convincing. I moved toward her and threw a jab. She blocked and countered with a hammer strike, which I subverted. I dropped to the ground and swept her leg. She hit the ground and I moved back before she could retaliate. I'd learned the hard way to never let her get me to the ground. She was fast. She whipped into her hold so quickly she made me think that somewhere in the process, she'd shifted to her animal. A snake. It wasn't vampire speed, but it was faster than any were animal I'd seen. The movement back cost me precious time, and she recovered, stood, and attacked with a series of kicks that caused me to retreat and go on the defensive. The room became nothing more than the sound of aggressive parries, strikes, kicks, and loud thuds from our falls and tosses to the ground. I landed a hip toss, hard, and before she could get back on her feet, I was over her, delivering several strikes. She blocked most of them, but finally said something that struck me harder than any blow she could have delivered. "I submit." She pushed the words through clenched teeth. It was barely a whisper, but I heard it. I'd just defeated Winter for the first time ever, and I had that pain in the ass Dexter to thank for it. Once she was on her feet, she grabbed a towel and patted her forehead dry. If I looked anything like she did, I needed to prepare for the stares and abhorrent looks we would get when we left. On the bright side, these looks stopped most of the people in the gym from wanting to spar with us. We were usually smeared in blood and covered with bruises when we were finished. But onlookers weren't aware that in a couple of days, there'd be no evidence we'd been in a fight. Which was why we alternated session times, hoping we wouldn't run into the same person during any 1 week. Sometimes we did, and we were met with expectant, inquiring gazes. I often wondered if they thought we knew secret makeup tricks.
"You might want to close your mouth," she suggested, strolling toward me.
I snapped it shut as I repeated her words. "I submit," over and over again. I memorized the tone and the lilt of them. I committed it all to memory with the assumption that it was the first and last time I would ever hear those words from Winter. I was pretty sure I'd be considered a bad winner if I did my happy dance, and maybe even broke into song.
"You have a lot of aggression in you. You're kind of hot."
"I totally get Ethan now." I frowned.
"What's wrong with you? That isn't something you should find sexy in a person. Ever," I said with an exasperated huff.
She shrugged. "A woman who can possibly kick my ass is sexy."
"Why are you all so disturbed?"
I took a drink from the bottle of water I'd grabbed out of my bag.
"We have a pack therapist. He's there for a reason. You should consider a daily visit. He's there for us, you know."
Her lips lifted in a sly grin.
"I don't think I need it."
"Trust me, you do. Because a woman punching you in the face is considered assault by most people's standards, not the prelude to a romantic liaison."
"Different strokes," she said dismissively, leaning against the wall, a smirk playing on her lips.
"No, it's not. Let's play a game. Let's say two women want to show they are interested in you. One person punches you, and the other person buys you a drink. Can you tell me which one is a chargeable offense and which one is a nice social gesture?"
She shrugged. "It really depends on the spirit in which each is delivered."
I exhaled a breath of defeat as I realized that was who she was. I added another page to my "something is wrong with you" mental profile of Winter. Laughing, she asked, "What's got you in a mood?" I assumed she knew the difference, but it was a lesson I fully intended to address later. "I'm worried about Stephen." She studied me for a long time.
"Don't be. This isn't the first time one of us has been arrested."
I slanted my eyes in her direction. "How many times for you?" The fact she needed time to count indicated it wasn't a small number.
"Arrested about 10 times, actually charged. 4. But they were dismissed each time."
"How many of them were for first-degree murder or manslaughter?"
"How do you know what he's been charged with?"
Warmth brushed my cheeks and the bridge of my nose. "I've been on Google and Wikipedia researching the charges he could get based on the video." Her face relaxed into a sympathetic smile, and when she spoke, her tone matched.
"They have an altered video and, thanks to Josh, no evidence that Stephen was even at the crime scene. If that's not enough, Ethan is an outstanding attorney. Believe me, I don't have any charges, and I probably deserved at least 2 of them. And the last one, who is so guilty. I'm really surprised the charges were dismissed."
She hit me lightly with her towel, and her smile widened.
"It's only a matter of time before you and Stephen are hugged up, giving each other little kisses and spouting your love for each other. And the annoying duo of Skyven can continue once again."
She rolled her eyes and mumbled,
"So annoying."
She grabbed her bag and started out the door of the dungeon.
"Don't pretend you don't miss him,"
I yelled after her. She stopped and considered my response.
"I do. I bet not nearly as much as you, though."
When I reached the pack's house, I parked behind Ethan's car, the gray Hennessy Venom GT which awed most people. Each time I saw it, I stared, trying to figure out what I was missing. I stood to the side of it, brows furrowed, looking over the sleek lines of the body, custom paint, large tires, and soft, buttery leather seats.
"It's just a car," I muttered, tilting my head to study it again.
"You'll never get it,"
Ethan said behind me. I turned to find him at the entrance of the house, nearly 20 feet away, leaning against the doorframe, a smirk lifting the corners of his lips.
"Freak." The smile faded as I approached, and his gaze traveled over the patches of raspberry and muddled blue marks on my face and arms. His fingers lightly traced along a fading bruise on my cheek.
You and Winter play too rough.
We do, but guess who got Winter to submit? I said. He leaned in, his breath warm against my lips as his tongue slipped out to taste them before he spoke.
Really?
He asked. Heat radiated from him. His hand slid around my waist, and he pulled me closer. I could feel him, all of him, as he responded to violence the way wares often did, with an odd attraction. You know that psychologist is here for us. Maybe you and Winter can go back to back so he can block out this morning for the same type of crazy, I suggested. He stepped in again. I sidestepped and slipped past him into the house. Grabbing hold of the back of my pants, he tugged me back against him, wrapped his arms around me and kissed my hair.
Congratulations, Sky.
I was happy about it. He seemed ecstatic, a little too enthusiastic. I could feel his enthusiasm against me. I pulled away, narrowed my eyes at him, and tried not to be disturbed by how much my winning fights excited him. It was weird. Ethan liked self-reliance, formidability, and strong fighting and self-defense skills. He'd never made a secret of it, but there was more to it than that. You know I'm never going to challenge anyone, right? He gave me a solemn look.
Sky, why would you? You're a beta now.
What? Beta? What are you talking about? His solemn look melted into a frown of incredulity.
How did you pass orientation?
I took the test and made a passing grade like everyone else. I shrugged, returning his incredulous look. And if you all ever consider making changes in the pack, you should start with that 200-question final exam. It's really unnecessary.
Well, if you'd listened instead of watching animals performing tricks, stupid human stunts, and a lion cub trying to roar for the first time, and yes, we all heard about it.
He gave me the same disparaging look he'd given me so often it had lost effectiveness.
You would know when someone has made it. They assume the same rank. Which is why a lot of were-animals vie for the affections of an alpha.
I knew that, but since Ethan and Sebastian were so effective at towing the line between questionable and ethical behavior, guarding the pack's secrets like a troll at a bridge, using the tactic of getting people to see the reality they want them to see, in layman's terms, lying, and keeping the pack safe, I couldn't imagine them delegating those responsibilities to anyone else. The idea of not being expected to challenge anyone was a relief. I didn't have it in me to do it, and I really didn't want to be a ranked pack member. But coincidentally, now I was. You know, I didn't mate with you for your position. He chuckled.
Believe me, I know that.
He strode past me and started down the hall. I wished I was above doing something as petty as sticking my tongue out when he turned his back, but I wasn't.
Real mature, Sky,
he said, his back still to me. When he turned, his lips were kinked into a condescending smirk.
As I've said many times before, you occasionally surprise me, but most times, you are quite predictable.
He continued down the hall with a slight limp from when the East Coast Alpha had crushed his ankle during a challenge a couple of days ago. It was almost healed, and probably would have healed faster if he'd actually adhered to Dr. Jeremy's protocol. But if Ethan was nothing else, he was stubborn to a fault. He was headed to the new addition to the house, or rather, the converted room that was now the new headquarters of the pack, formerly known as Worgen. The Worgen pack had been absorbed into ours when Sebastian decided he would no longer allow fringe packs in his territory, after one had attacked and almost fatally wounded me. Of the people who joined our pack, the Worgen had proved to be our greatest asset. In the past,
We'd used them if we needed anything IT-related done. Gavin and Steven called them the geeks. I'd thought it was a term of endearment. But after walking into the room one too many times when they were playing their games or speaking Klingon, I'd learned it was more than apropos. They were a different type of were-animal. I wondered what information they were getting for Ethan now, as I followed him down the hall to their new office. Sebastian called my name before I could get there. I turned and went to the open door of his office. He extended his hand to a chair, inviting me to sit. Once I did, he relaxed back in his oversized leather chair. Although he overwhelmed his office as he did most rooms, the vast area suited him. A large executive desk of dark wood with carved designs along the front anchored the space, and matching bookcases lined the back wall. Wildlife paintings, something seen throughout the house, covered the walls. All of Sebastian's paintings were of wolves baring their teeth in attack poses. Most people had pictures that relaxed them in their offices. It was unsettling that these comforted him. His appearance never belied his feral alertness. He was handsome, no doubt about it, but the wolf was always front and center. It wasn't something he could turn on and off because it was entwined into his being, his very essence. Even with the knowledge that the bottom row of his bookshelf housed first editions of John Keats and Robert Frost and the poetry of Allen Ginsberg and Nikki Giovanni, which I had discovered while snooping in his office, I was very aware that I was facing a predator. After appraising me for a long time, he finally settled upon a wisp of a smile that tugged at the corners of his lips. When he spoke, his voice was soft and earnest.
A pack can be complicated, and the nuances of its functions and the members' effects on it can be hard to understand and describe.
He shifted forward, his gaze holding mine with an astute intensity.
The emotional state of it is more fragile than we often care to admit, and some members have more of an influence on it than others. Most often it's the one we least expect. You have never ceased being an enigma, possessing a strength that is always underestimated. Your anxiety is palpable, and your high distress is noticeable. It reeks and feels uncomfortable.
I blinked several times, trying to grasp what he was saying. "Are you saying I'm stressing everyone out?" I asked incredulously.
"I felt it even before you walked into the house."
His eyes went to the floor, and I tried not to gawk at him. But it was the first time Sebastian's unwavering strength had folded for a moment. He was concerned for me, or rather perplexed by the situation. Or maybe it was a confluence of both. "I can't help how I feel. I can't control it." He rested his elbows on the table and then steepled his fingers in front of him. His tone remained soft and low, as if he were trying to soothe an agitated animal.
"Stephen isn't going to prison. I give you my word."
I didn't have any doubt that Stephen wasn't going to prison. It was how this goal would be achieved that bothered me. Sebastian couldn't guarantee that Stephen would be acquitted of the charges. I was sure Ethan and Sebastian had a nuclear option already in place. But how radical would it be? would Stephen have to leave the country? Would we have to resort to dark tactics to free him? There were so many ifs about the situation. Sebastian screwed his eyes together and winced. "Sorry," I said. I wasn't sure what a surge of anxiety felt like, but from the look of him, it was like bile creeping up into his throat. "But you can't promise me he'll be acquitted, can you?" After several moments of deliberation, he nodded.
"Yes, I can guarantee he will be acquitted."
Wow, I guess Sebastian is a wizard. Despite Sebastian's confidence and bravado, I was still concerned about consequences if Stephen was found guilty. The only other option would be for them to send him away. He'd be a fugitive and couldn't come back to the States. Before I could question his assertion and ask if sending Stephen away was their backup plan, there was a knock at the door, and I saw unruly chestnut waves of hair before Quinn, a former member of the Worgen Pack, who went by the moniker Casper, stepped in. I'd assumed the name was a reference to the friendly ghost. However, when I'd asked, he'd given me some long, convoluted answer that had eventually caused me to lose interest. Apparently, he got the name because he was capable of getting into any system without leaving a cyber fingerprint behind. No one ever knew he'd been there. He might now go by Casper, but I was pretty sure if he kept hacking, he would eventually go by the name Inmate Number Whatever. Quinn seemed to be the Worgen's alpha. He possessed a quiet, coiled strength that was quite noticeable. Even when he was relaxed, he appeared restrained and tense, as if he struggled with control. Maybe that was it. He was struggling to control his animal half. Most of our pack had a symbiotic relationship with their animal half, so much so that it was often difficult to decipher the line between person and beast. My curiosity got the better of me as I speculated about him. I watched him with intensity, and he gave me a forced half-smile as he entered the room. Oddly, he looked more comfortable with Sebastian than with me. Was I really putting off emotions that heavily? Did he view me as having a toxic aura? When his nose flared and he noticeably smelled the air, I inhaled too. But I didn't smell anything except for hints of cedar with an undercurrent of cinnamon. I gather Quinn smelled something different. Was anxiety as easy to detect as fear, which had a strong, undeniable scent?
"They still haven't processed Stephen."
It felt like Quinn was offering me the information instead of Sebastian. "You can see that information?" I asked.
"Yes. I cloned their system. I can see everything they do. And once Stephen is processed, I'll let you know so bail can be issued," he said in a flat tone.
Maybe it was just me, but when you admitted to doing something that blatantly illegal, you should at least have a tinge of shame in your voice. Sebastian nodded.
"What about Dexter? Have you found him?"
He shook his head.
"I'm monitoring all his financials. He hasn't used his passport, and there aren't any records of him flying, so I assume he's still in the country. I can prohibit him from accessing any money. I think it will force him to surface faster," Quinn offered.
Wow, that doesn't sound remotely legal. Sebastian considered his suggestion for an extended period of time. I made myself believe that he was debating the morality and legality of doing it and battling his conscience. I was eternally optimistic.
"Don't do anything to Dexter's account," Sebastian finally instructed. "I can do it without triggering suspicion," Quinn said with confidence and a look that said he'd been waiting for the okay to meet the challenge. "But if you don't, we are not in a position for you to fail. I suspect, if Dexter is as cunning as he's proven to be, It will be a trap. You do it and it'll trigger something.
They've never caught me before.
And then he listed all the websites and agencies and banks he'd hacked in the past. I wished I hadn't heard that. I really wanted plausible deniability. My attention bounced between the two of them. Sebastian's eyes stayed steady on him, but not with apprehension like mine, but with consideration. Sebastian possessed power, resources, aggression, and an overwhelming presence that commanded subjugation. Quinn and his crew were just as dangerous in their own right. When it came to hacking and cyber attacks, they had us beat. It was never easy to guess what went through Sebastian's mind. I could only speculate because he was always playing the long game, putting the pack at an advantage in the worst-case scenario. He did it with ease. And it wasn't until he had shown his hand that a person realized they'd been out of their depth the whole time. He finally shook his head, dismissing Quinn along with his proposal.
No. I don't trust Dexter not to be setting a trap. Let's be more careful.
Once Quinn left, closing the door behind him, I gave Sebastian the same shaming look I'd given him when he'd failed to adequately address my discovery of how the pack was financed. Our pack was large, and each member gave it a percentage of their personal income, which was invested in several holdings and businesses owned by the pack. A stipend was issued to each member based on money invested in the pack. The Worgen pack took a different approach. When Sebastian had had his welcome to the pack, I'm sorry I had to disband yours meeting, I'd expected him to at least vehemently denounce their past ways of doing things, especially how they financed their pack, by funneling money out of bank accounts. They used the polite and willfully strong word funneling, as opposed to stealing, the accurate word. And instead of telling them that all stealing was wrong and wouldn't be tolerated in this pack, Sebastian had told them they would have to stop stealing money out of bank accounts. In response, they'd astutely pointed out that they didn't steal. They simply funneled a dollar from every account holder in the bank. The problem was that for most major banks, a dollar out of each account could easily hit high 6 to 7 figures. I'd developed muscle fatigue from scowling, my mouth dropping in morbid disbelief and glaring at Sebastian over his handling of the situation. The new additions to our group had seemed obviously out of their depth, used to a different way of life, and had now been absorbed into a pack with strange politics, rules, and fealty expectations. I'd questioned whether they would assimilate well, and I'd seen the same concern in Sebastian's eyes as he'd looked upon his new members, dressed in their t-shirts with weird slogans, very different from Ethan's brother Josh, who wore his ironically. And a couple of them had worn rings on their fingers, their homage to the Lord of the Rings. I'd realized assimilation wasn't possible. At best, we should expect them to adapt. And during that meeting, they hadn't gotten the chastising I'd expected. Instead, Sebastian had said he was very aware of what they were capable of, what they had done in the past, and how most of them had acquired their nicknames. Instead of condemning their deeds, Sebastian had pointed out that the more they did things like that, the bigger the risk was of them being caught, and how important it was to minimize risk. And as I'd stood with my mouth gaping open, giving him my full-on look of judgment, he'd smiled and shrugged.
I told them to stop.
I guess being the pack's moral compass is my job.
Really? Because I've heard you tell people to stop things. It usually involves the weird eye thing, growling, and occasionally your hand wrapping around someone's throat. That, Mr. Alpha, was the most pitiful berating I've ever seen you give. It's fine if you're scolding a kid for taking goodies from a store, but their funneling is a federal crime.
And they said they wouldn't do it.
"When exactly did they say that?" I'd asked. "I didn't hear that one time. Did they breathe it in Morse code or something?" Sebastian had looked over his shoulder at the guys, his tone deep, firm, and casually dismissive as he had asked,
"You all won't do that again, will you?"
Almost in unison, with mischief in their eyes and half-smirks on their lips, they'd said,
"Of course not."
"You heard them. Of course not."
And he'd left me behind. As I sat across from Sebastian, reliving that day with the nearly acquired Worgen pack, I felt like I was experiencing déjà vu. Just as with the conversation before, a charming smile had settled over Sebastian's features, and it was quite easy to be disarmed by it. It held a beguiling allure, intentionally generated to make a person forget they were dealing with an apex predator with human intellect. Being aware that he was doing it didn't make it easier to ignore. I was just cognizant that I was falling for it. I settled back in my chair and relaxed the scowl and the squint in my narrowed eyes. "Okay, it's all fun and games until SWAT teams and the FBI get involved," I said coolly.
"Sky, you're being dramatic."
"Sebastian," I said firmly, standing my ground.
"I do believe we've had this conversation quite often. Let me ask you, Sky, has it changed anything?" "What conversation?"
Ethan asked, only knocking to notify us of his entrance. Sebastian grinned.
"Apparently, I've failed to adhere to Sky's strict code of black and white ethics, and have delved too deep in shades of gray for her liking. It seems I am once again on the receiving end of her scathing looks of judgment and disapproval. Perhaps at this point, I should be quivering under her harsh displeasure."
"Oh, great. He thinks he's funny, too."
The mocking half-grin confirmed it.
Behind the smile remained unwavering imperiousness, a constant reminder of the alpha that lingered.
"Did you need something else, Sky? Or do you wish to continue to provide an assessment of my dereliction of duties as the alpha? Or have you forgotten I am the alpha?"
I smiled, genteel and demure, and spoke in an overly cloying tone. "Mr. Alpha, I could never forget that. And if by chance I do, you'll just do that weird eye thing and growl to give me a friendly reminder." This time, I exposed my teeth when I gave him a sugary smile. He leaned back in his chair, studying me.
"Really? It hasn't seemed to work on you lately. Perhaps I need to change my tactics."
Sebastian didn't bring out my fight-or-flight response the way he once had, but I was never unaware that he was a very dangerous were-animal.
"But you are different. Always have been."
He wasn't evaluating me as the same oddity, the magical abnormality he had in his pack, or the woman who he worked so diligently to hide their secrets from. And I wasn't under any illusions that some of those secrets were still there. I held his gaze for longer than I'd intended to.
"Very different," he acknowledged quietly.
His look of unsettled curiosity remained as he directed his attention to Ethan.
"Are you sure he will get bail?"
Ethan nodded.
"He was arrested for a triple homicide and animal cruelty, so it will be really high."
"He didn't kill an animal," I snapped, not at Ethan, but the situation. "They were about to shift and attack him. If they'd had their way, he would be the one dead. And the other one had already shifted. It was justified." I was fuming, and some of that anger was directed at Sebastian. He was the one who'd sent Stephen out to confront that pack. And I had to shoulder some of that guilt as well,
because I was the reason Sebastian no longer allowed fringe packs in his territory.
We know that, Sky, Ethan said softly.
I tried to shrug off my anxiety and frustration, because based on the tension in Ethan's shoulders, he was feeling it as if it were his own.
I can see what happens at the bail hearing. Between that and the arraignment, I suspect the charges will be downgraded. They've no evidence except an altered video, which probably won't be admissible.
I was used to Ethan being overly confident and borderline arrogant about everything. But now it was distilled. Not totally gone, but not nearly as flagrant. I wondered if at any point he'd considered that dealing with misdemeanors, corporate law, and pack business hadn't adequately prepared him for defending an accused murderer. A murder trial was different from one for assault. In the latter, he could probably handle most of it before the trial and strike a deal. Ethan moved closer to me, and my gaze locked with his, making that connection that was intimate and solely ours. I forgot others were in the room. It was just us. Pressing his hand against my cheek, he said my name, his tone honeyed, low, and velvety smooth. He spoke almost in supplication.
I need you to trust me, okay? Stephen will be fine.
The heaviness seemed to lift, and I couldn't explain it. Ethan seemed to be sharing my burden, and I willingly gave it. I wasn't sure if it was real, but it was definitely something I needed.
Chapter 2. Ethan made a face as I picked up his phone and checked it for the fourth time.
Sky, I told you they aren't likely to release him on a Sunday, and I can assure you they won't do it at 11 o'clock at night. Tomorrow. We will have him out by tomorrow.
His tone was easy and gentle, but I'd heard the light tinge of irritation. Blindly following him or Sebastian and accepting that they would handle it was difficult. I wanted to be proactive. Sebastian shouldn't have sent Stephen, I finally said. Ethan placed his hand over mine and gave it a squeeze.
Sky, we aren't having this conversation again because it won't change anything.
His voice tightened, and the change in his mood was apparent. I couldn't see my injuries from the attack by the small pack, but I could still feel them, and they'd been bad. Dr. Jeremy had thought I was going to lose an eye. I'd had multiple breaks, and I'd been in so much pain and so afraid that I couldn't shift. The tense muscles in Ethan's neck were a reminder that he was remembering that day, too. He hadn't responded well to it. I understand why we don't allow lone packs. I don't understand why Stephen has to deal with them the most often.
He has the best temperament. He's less threatening and often chooses diplomacy when most wouldn't.
Ethan failed to add that Stephen's gentle demeanor and cherubic appearance caused people to underestimate him to their peril, which was what had happened the night he'd been arrested.
Did you enjoy yourself?
Ethan asked, using the rearview mirror to look at the canvases placed against the back seat. The attempt at a smile was the same one he'd worn throughout the wine and canvas event we'd used to pass the time. I looked over at his canvas, the nice lines, the strokes that didn't look like the work of an amateur, and the complimenting colors that had drawn several people to our area to look at it. Ethan had played the part, although his emotions were never easy to hide. I felt them. He hadn't enjoyed it, but he'd done it for me. The day had been his attempt to distract me, and for the most part he had. Between dinner, going to visit Claudia at her gallery, and wine and canvas,
I'd only checked his phone or asked him to check it a few times. It was fun. Did you have fun? I asked.
Of course. In my final days, I will remember the day I painted love on a canvas while drinking cheap, overpriced wine. Yes, the memory will stay with me forever.
Your sarcasm is neither warranted nor appreciated. I shot back, grinning, and playfully jabbed him with my elbow. He ran his tongue over his lips.
You liked it. That's what matters.
He paused for a moment.
We can store them in my garage.
He looked back at the canvases.
Which is a better fate than they deserve. Once we have all your things in my house, we'll find a place for them. I'm assuming there won't be too many of them.
What? I spluttered. Once we have all my things? Ethan continued to speed down the road, but his eyes drifted in my direction, and his brow furrowed.
Yes. I assumed you would move into my house. It's bigger. The forest behind it is larger. More space for us to shift and roam.
He kept speaking, and I really wanted him to stop. I hadn't thought about our living arrangements and wasn't ready to discuss them. Ethan brought the conversation to an abrupt stop as he pulled into my driveway.
Your vampire is here.
His voice had become rigid and cool, a contrast from his playful tone. Quell walked out from the shadows, his face expressionless and his eyes hollow. When I got out of the car, he tentatively advanced in my direction. Ethan had eased to my side and taken hold of my hand. Quell didn't need to breathe, but he sucked in a breath anyway, as his eyes trailed from my face and down my arm to Ethan's fingers interlinked with mine. I gave Ethan's hand a squeeze. Will you give us a minute? I asked him softly. Ethan hesitated, giving Quell a hard look before barely nodding in agreement. Quell and I watched as he disappeared into the house.
Will you walk with me?
Quell requested quietly. He didn't wait for an answer. He strolled into the woods, into the thick, bosky area, until the many trees that surrounded my home obscured us. When he stopped, I left several feet between us. For several minutes, his midnight-colored, sorrow-drenched eyes remained fixed on me. They were so hard to hold. Even thinking fondly of when they'd once been an odd, vibrant green didn't make it any easier. And the long-awaited silence that existed between us was becoming increasingly difficult to bear. Closing the distance I had put between us, I gently touched his hand, hoping it would urge him to speak. The silence continued, cold, uncomfortable, and onerous. Closing the distance, he swallowed up any space I'd left between us, his movement nothing more than a blur. Leisurely, his finger trailed down my arm until it met the bare skin of my fingers, which he stroked absently for several moments. Then he stopped all movement and stared past me, the heaviness of his mood displayed solemnly on his face.
Michaela's dead,
he finally said. The air carried his soft words, and they continued to echo. I was angry with myself for feeling guilty about killing Michaela. There should never have been any guilt, because her death had been deserved. For years, she had terrorized me and my pack for the sheer pleasure of it. She was undeserving of my remorse, and if it weren't for Quell standing in front of me, I doubted I would have had any of those feelings. But I wasn't remorseful that she was dead. I felt bad because I knew it had hurt him, and that was the last thing I'd wanted to do. Quell and I shared a tragic existence, one that couldn't be easily dismissed. He turned away from me and walked away. I followed him through the crowded, lush forest on a path that had been made by Stephen and me, constantly taking the same way whenever we went into the woods. Most of the time, it was my paws that trampled down the coarse grass. Quell walked slowly, his hands by his side, his long fingers periodically stroking mine nonchalantly. I was aware of the coolness that pressed against my skin every time he touched me. We'd been walking in silence for several minutes when the mood changed. It wasn't heavy, but an acceptable resolve that seemed fitting as we stood in the deep, verdant area, surrounded by trees, in a somnolent quiet, an easy silence that existed between us. When he turned to face me, his eyes still looked sorrowful and withdrawn. I remembered the time I'd forced him to feed from me because I hadn't been able to let him die. I glanced over at the large leaves that extended from the poplars, reminded of how vibrant and green his eyes used to be. That color was evocative of the plant Hedacus, which he'd fed from instead of humans. He'd abjectly refused blood from humans, whom he'd considered unworthy of the humanity they possessed.
"I miss you,"
he admitted softly. His voice carried lightly in the wind. "I miss you too." I said it, and I meant it. I felt a pang of guilt and betrayal about missing another man when I had Ethan. But the relationship I had with Quell was so different from what I had with anyone else. It transcended romance and friendship. It was odd, unexplainable, and something I treasured. Its nebulous existence was difficult for most people to understand. "Ethan said you have a donor now. How is that going?" I asked, aware of the way his gaze trailed along my features and down the curve of my jaw to the lines of my neck, where it stayed. I saw the thirst, something he'd denied himself. It was inexplicably who he was, no matter how much he denied his urges. At the end of the day, he was a vampire, and he had bloodlust. He required blood to survive. Although he approached it with a detachment that seemed clinical at best, he enjoyed taking human blood.
I had a donor,
he murmured, and then turned to walk away. I grabbed his arm, stopping him. I turned him to face me.
What do you mean, had?
I asked with repressed fear and agitation. I remembered the time he'd gone through bloodlust and killed several people. Not just people. Women who'd looked strangely like me. He continued to move.
I sent her away.
How long ago?
About a week and a half ago.
Why? I asked, rooted in place, allowing him to increase the distance between us. But there was more than just space between us. I knew he'd figured out I was responsible for Michaela's death. Confession felt better than accusation, so I blurted out, "I killed Michaela."
"I know."
His shoulders sagged into the sigh.
"That's why I'm here,"
he admitted. "For what? Retribution? Revenge?" Quell's eyes widened, then he frowned.
"Of course not,"
he said. And in a blink, he was in front of me, with a stake in hand. He studied me for a few minutes before placing it in my hands and grasping them between his. He lifted the stake to his chest.
"I'm ready for you to do the same to me."
Wincing at his request, I let his words replay in my head in a loop as if they'd somehow change, hopeful I'd missed something or he'd misspoken. "What?"
"I'm ready for you to do the same to me," he repeated.
I knew what he was talking about, but I needed him to say it. I needed him to vocalize that he was asking me to take his life. Perhaps if he heard how ridiculous it sounded, he'd recant. Without missing a beat, or even reconsidering his words, he said them again, voice flat.
You've taken the life of my creator, and now I am asking you to do the same for me.
Anger rose out of my confusion. I gawked at him, disgusted. What is wrong with you? He shook his head and looked stunned by my anger, as if he'd thought I would have willingly accepted taking his life for no other reason than he'd requested it. As if it were some odd circle I needed to complete, or some peculiar task I had been committed to by killing Michaela. Why does everything have to be so dramatic with you? I shouted. I spun around, the stake still clenched in my hand, and walked so fast back toward the house I was nearly jogging.
Sky?
He said my name again, entreating me with a gentle timbre, as he requested understanding.
This is inevitable. It's been a long time coming.
I hadn't realized how much progress I'd made toward the house, and was just several feet away when I sensed Ethan's presence in the darkness. Cloaked by it, he stayed out of sight. Once again, the gentle lilt of my name crossed Quell's lips. It didn't sound nearly as ominous or cruel as his request. It implored forgiveness, though I wasn't willing to give it. I was so angry, I couldn't tamp it down. And as much as I wanted to ignore that little tug of guilt that lingered, it emerged as well. I did what most people did in a situation like this. I lashed out. I spun around and pulled my lips back, exposing my teeth. What do you want me to say? That I'm sorry?
No. I want you to honor my request.
I will not be a performer in your fucking production of angst and self-deprecation. I closed my eyes and inhaled the air, hoping it would cleanse the memories and soothe my fiery anger. It didn't. Rage blazed in me and rode me hard, along with the guilt. I forgot all the cruel things Michaela had done, all the havoc she'd wreaked, and only remembered that I'd killed the one person who linked Quell to the vampires. His creator, the person he'd loved unconditionally. I searched my emotions. Everything had melded together, and I couldn't sort them out. Anger, frustration, sorrow, confusion. For several moments, we stood in silence. His flat, despondent eyes seized my emotions in a manner I couldn't understand. I stared at him. She was cruel, and so are you. If you want to end your life, there are several ways you could do it. Instead, you came here and made me a participant in your self-loathing pity party. Don't bring me into this. Don't ask me to understand the screwed-up relationship you had with Michaela. And don't you fucking dare ask me to assist you in ending a life you don't feel worthy of living now that she's gone. I thought you were better than this. You want to die? I'm sure there's a line of people willing to do it.
What you perceive as cruelty is nothing more than my final request for kindness.
I didn't want his soft, gentle explanation. I wanted him to be angry and emotionally uncontrolled the way I was, so it would be easier for me to deal with everything. I'd lost this battle because this was exactly what Michaela had wanted. If she couldn't have him, no one else could either, even as a friend. She'd wanted him in a perpetual state of sorrow, and she'd accomplished that. I looked at his grief-stricken eyes and felt lost, helpless. I didn't know what to do. If only I could get the same kindness you request from me, from you, I growled back. Ethan had emerged from the darkness and was just inches from me.
I spiked the stake into the ground, embedding it in the soil near Ethan's feet. He looked at it, then at me, and allowed his gaze to travel in Quell's direction before he knelt to pick it up. I growled and bared my teeth. They were clenched so tightly my jaw ached. "Don't you dare pick that up." I was fully aware that what I was reluctant and unable to do, Ethan was fully capable of. My scowl relaxed as he looked at me with defiance. I knew it was hard for him to deny a challenge, and I'd just challenged him. That beastly part of him that denied subjugation was defiant. The predator flashed, but he reined it in as he stood and took several steps away from the stake. I slowly backed away, and Quell moved in my direction. I heard a hard thump, and I assumed it was Ethan's palm hitting Quell's chest to stop him, because I heard Ethan say, "Let her go." I was glad Ethan had stopped him. I was in a bad place where I couldn't talk to him and be civil or kind. The cool air breezing across my skin wasn't enough. I still felt like I was suffocating. "Damn you, Quell." Once I started walking, there wasn't any doubt where I would end up. I strode past the long stretch of forest, a vast area that gave me the space I needed to keep the necessary distance from my neighbor. I enjoyed my privacy, but this was one of the times when I wished David lived closer. Next door would be great. The sun had long set, and the moonlight lit the path up to his darkened home. "Please be up," I thought as I knocked on his door. David answered the door with a nearly full wine glass in hand. He assessed my appearance, and his smile faded. His lips turned down into a frown. "Oh, what is it, pumpkin spice?" he said, stepping aside to let me in. "Really?" But it was better than being called kitten or a cream-filled pastry, so I dealt with it. I walked in. Trent, his partner, was sitting on the sofa. As usual, I was underdressed in my V-neck t-shirt and dark blue jeans. They both had on slacks and pristine, crisp button-down shirts, and as usual, they had bowl-sized wine glasses in hand. "What's the matter, sweetie?" David asked. "I don't want to talk about it," I mumbled, walking into his outstretched arms. He wrapped them around me and held me tight. Relaxed, I appreciated the warmth of his hug and rested my head against his chest. Then I felt the heavy heat and weight of another body. Trent's arms encircled me, his face pressed against my back. "Did I make it weird? This is weird. I think I just made it weird," he mumbled into my shirt. "So very weird," I agreed, my words muffled as I pressed my face deeper into David's shirt. "You want me to move?" he asked. "No." We stayed in the bizarre three-person hug for several minutes before untangling from it. I made my way to the sofa, and minutes after I had made myself comfortable, David handed me a large glass of wine and placed a tray of cupcakes in front of me. "You definitely know how to make a day better," I said, and took a long drink. I wished it really would have made me feel better, but it didn't. The cloud of despair hung heavily around me. Quell wanted me to kill him. For so many years, I'd underestimated his connection with Michaela, and I would probably die never really knowing or understanding the attachment he had to her solely because she was the one who'd created him. He was the very person who had given up on humanity, which made it hard to understand how he could cling to someone who'd brazenly chosen to do everything possible to be inhumane. I gave David and Trent a faint smile, aware they were looking at me, waiting for me to talk. I just couldn't gather the right words to say that someone had just asked me to kill them, to assist them in their own suicide.
Can we talk about it later?
I asked. They weren't subtle about hiding their relief. They had been plunged into the other world and were privy to information others didn't have. They had been introduced to a realm of darkness, violence, supernatural politics, and posturing. I didn't blame them for wanting to distance themselves from it, to be blissfully ignorant of the many things I had to deal with, to hold on to that innocent part of them. I relaxed back in the sofa, wine in hand, shooting them derisive looks as they became engrossed in a show with surgically enhanced bodies, extensions flinging through the air, and long manicured fingers pointing at other women as they made their mean remarks.
Oh, sweetie, you turn into a wolf once a month. Don't judge us,
Trent said as he took a sip from his glass and gave me a playful grin. I wrinkled my nose.
I'm judging, and you can't stop me.
He shrugged and made a dramatic gesture, as though he were flinging long hair back as well. And you can't make me care. I laughed, because he knew I was a closeted lover of these things, and watching them with David and Trent made them even more entertaining. I let the shows enthrall me, and the wine make me hazy enough to let the image of Quell's face slip away. Being tipsy from wine and a chocolate rush had put me in a better mood, a calmer frame of mind.
I've decided I'm going to stay here forever, I informed them as I placed my glass on the table in front of me.
I knew David would eventually refill it again. We both made faces at the 5 empty bottles sitting on the table.
Like you can stay away from him, David teased.
I wasn't sure who he was more enamored with, Ethan or Stephen.
I'll visit him periodically.
He and Trent gave each other a look, and then directed said look at me.
I'm sure you will,
David said with a miscreant grin, and I don't blame you.
Not for that. I actually enjoy talking to him and being around him. You know that, right?
Among other things, I'm sure.
I ignored them and tried to focus on the TV, but in my peripheral vision, I could see the looks they kept giving me. And just when another spat started on the TV, with heads rolling so hard, their extensions smacked them in their faces, manicured fingers being pushed in another woman's face, and enough scathing names being spat to garner our attention again, someone knocked on the door. It wasn't someone. We all knew who it was. Ethan. They hesitated before answering, waiting for me to give them the okay. I nodded once. David opened the door, and before Ethan could ask, he said,
She's here.
I know, Ethan said. That ability was something I'd always been curious about. When I'd first met him, he seemed to have the gift of always being able to find me, and I'd attributed it to were-animals being good hunters, but I'd had no idea why I could always find him, even before we were mated. Something had happened after we'd performed that spell together to remove his dark elf magic. Somehow, we'd become linked. Ever since then, I could feel a magical nudge in his direction, a magical connection that always led me to him. The more I found out about Ethan, the more complicated I realized our connection might be. Best case scenario, we were linked by that spell. Worst case?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.